Now then, for the first time, we'll have all four Irish provinces playing knockout European rugby after the Six Nations this season. Leinster, winners away to Wasps, will host Ulster, who themselves came from 13-0 down to win 14-13 at Welford Road. That Leinster-Ulster game presumably at the Aviva Stadium. And then Munster will travel to Edinburgh. They were 9-7 winners against Exeter on Saturday. There is an all-French affair as well. Toulouse away to Racing, and then Saracens will host Glasgow. And Connacht, for their part, will be away to Sale in the Challenge Cup. We have Eddie O'Sullivan with us and Rory O'Connor from the Irish Independent as well. Rory in studio, hello.
Hi, Joe.
And you're there, Eddie. I think we're going to have you in full Technicolor.
Yeah. Oh, scary thought.
Look
scary
at this. Thought. It's a hell of a close-up.
Too close to comfort.
No, it's fine. Come on in. So, also going on this morning, the Irish team headed off to the Algarve for their week's training. Is it a week's training?
5 days, back
five
on Friday.
Days.
Yeah.
Okay. They did it last year. They all seem to enjoy it.
Yeah.
Get away from the cold and get away from you lot, I think is the point.
Yeah, get away from the bubble. Or create an even bigger bubble. They like the Carton House bubble, but it's even more protected out in Spain. They did it without Ty Byrne and Ian Henderson, though, which is a bit of a concern ahead of the Six Nations. But I'm sure they'll get some decent work done over there. And I think it's about 17 degrees, so it's not too warm, but it's warmer than it is here anyway.
The word on both Byrne and Henderson is they're certainly out for the first two games of the Six Nations.
Yeah, Henderson sounds more serious. Okay. Byrne is... he injured his knee. I think he hyperextended his knee on Saturday, about 67 minutes into the game. And he's out for the first two games, certainly. And Henderson, they said several weeks, but I'd say looking like, you know, the first three games anyway.
Okay. The other news I saw, by the way, over the weekend, so Simon Zeebo scored his 12th try in 18 games. He confirmed he did hear racist abuse in Belfast, if you were following that story. He said, and this may upset people who are over the age of 40, he said, it was an elderly man, 40 plus. That's why it annoyed me a bit. I'd be quite bulletproof with things like that, but if I was just to say nothing and accept it, I wouldn't be putting up much of a fight for myself. I don't want to come across as a weak character for my kids. I stand up for something if I believe in it. So they were Simon Zeebo's comments after the game at the weekend. Let's start with the action then. So Munster against Exeter on the Saturday. I know you were over in the UK for the two games there, Rory. So 9-7, Eddie. Joey Carberry, 20-20 with the boot. Rob Baxter said afterwards, it was a bit like two bulls banging away at each other out there, wasn't it? Nobody really got any momentum. Van Graan said, definitely the toughest game of rugby since I came to Munster. What did you make of it?
Yeah, it was in terms of attrition, it was a cracking game. I thought that really at the end of the day, Baxter summed it up pretty well. I mean, both sides went at it pretty hot and heavy. I think, though, Munster deserved to win based on the way they defended. I mean, if you can hold a team like Exeter scoreless for 67 minutes, you deserve to win a game. And it wasn't that Exeter didn't have possession. Exeter had enough of ball to win that game, and they couldn't break Munster down. They don't tend to change the way they play Exeter. They're very attritional, but they failed to break Leinster down last year. But Munster gave one of those performances where they just weren't taking a step back. And I think Ty Byrne again and Carberry, the two game changers for Munster this year, you know, that they didn't have last year. Ty Byrne was superb at the breakdown. I mean, O'Mahony was good as well, to be fair, and a lot of guys had good games, but Byrne had a big impact at that. He was a nightmare for Exeter, plus the fact then that Carberry played a really good game, kept his nerve, made his kicks. You know, I just always felt Munster were going to get the other side of it as the game wore on. Once they kept defending, they could have had a defensive lapse and lost the game, but once they kept defending the way they were defending, I just felt they were going to wear Exeter down, and it was a fantastic victory against a very good team.
What about Munster in attack, Eddie?
Well, I think, again, it was a day for defences. I mean, like, Exeter were very aggressive again, you know, but we haven't seen Munster attack really well yet this year against good teams, so it is an issue. But I think it's Cup Rugby there last Saturday, and, you know, you just say, look, whatever gets across the line. I think there are other questions for them down the track, but I think they've got a very good draw as well. I think they've got the peach of the draw there against Edinburgh, even though it is away. If you had to pick a team to play or that other seven, you'd pick Edinburgh, I think, you know.
Yeah. Rory, I appreciate you were in the press box over at Welford Road watching this Munster game on mute on a phone. So We'll take that into account with your judgment on it, but give us your main take.
It's a strange way to watch a game, actually, because I think, you know, I think when you're watching that either in Thomond Park or with the sound turned up, and you can get the kind of sense of the atmosphere and the tension, and talking to people who were there, they certainly talked a lot about the fact that there was just real tension in the air, and I wonder, did that feed into the players? It just was a turnover fest, and they just lacked the continuity, certainly in that second half. Every time one team seemed to get on top, they either gave it away, or there were so many poaches going on. And I think you have to recognise the achievement that Munster have made in getting out of a tough pool, particularly when they got themselves in a bit of a hole. But if they are to push on further in the semi-final, which is this is their third time getting to the knockouts in a row after a fallow period. They've gotten to the semi-finals in the last two seasons. They have recruited well, despite losing Simon Zeebo, and want to go on and win this tournament. It's a stated ambition that they have, certainly to get to a final and then give themselves a chance. I think they'll need to be better than they have been over the course of the pool. We've seen really good glimpses of what they're capable of, and Eddie's right, the defence on Saturday, the character they showed. I mean, we may never know how much pain Peter Romani played through on Saturday, but he certainly looked like a guy who was fighting his bodies at times. Carberry's shown real resolve. There's a lot to like about the way they got there, but you would like to see them rise above a challenge like that to kind of, you know, get out of the stranglehold that Exeter put them in. And while you recognise the achievement of getting out and winning the game, which was a tough game to win, I would like to see them seize the moment a little bit more and not kind of fall over the line a little bit. All that being said, when they were on their own line within that clutch moment, Billy Holland getting up and winning that line out was just they won that big moment, which was the winning of the game in the end. And I think that is to be admired, albeit you just wonder about their ability to get to Newcastle and beat one of the top three or four teams based on their pool performances, which were a little bit inconsistent.
So that Billy Holland steal, Eddie, was crucial, and that came after one of Munster's very few periods in the Exeter 22, where I think Conway had tried to kick and chase down the line, hadn't worked out, and Conor Murray had made maybe not the best decision. And in the first half, Munster had about 1% of territory in the Exeter 22, so they were struggling to spend any time in the opposition 22, and I guess I had the very lucky position. I get to watch it in the studio, this one with Shane Jennings and Matt Williams, and they were looking at the Exeter defence for a lot of the game. So it was certainly, it was shooting up, and it was shooting up on the outside. Clearly, Exeter didn't want Munster to get the ball out wide to Conway or to Keith Earl. So when Munster are in that position, when a team is shooting up on them and shooting up on the outside, kind of that umbrella-shaped defence, what do we want them to do? How do we want them to react in an ideal world?
Well, the first thing I would say is that if you look at the terms of territory and possession, you know, Munster can get a little bit, I suppose, of energy, or the fact that they had very little possession and very little territory. So they would have had a difficulty scoring a lot of tries on Saturday against anybody with that sort of stats. They were like less than 40% in both. But having said that, if they're to break down defence, when defence comes up and in like that, there's two ways. You can try and go around it, and the ways to go around it is over the top, which is never a good idea because it gets picked off, or the hang time's so long that they cover it. Or you throw spot passes out the back off a second receiver, not a first receiver. So that means the player maker has to come out probably around second centre. Other than that, and there's probably not Munster's forte, what they should have done when the team playing up and in is they should spread them out and go through them. I mean, what you do is you spread out your attack, and that means the defence has to spread out, and you pick soft shoulders in between them. And that's kind of down, that is in Munster's barrel, like that sort of capacity to play north-south rugby. But they probably didn't adjust to that. They still tried to go around the corners at times and got turned back in. Would have been better off if they hadn't a way of going around the corner, which for me was a spot pass off the second receiver. They should have just taken up the guts. But to do that, they need to spread Exeter out more. And that's probably where they could have made an adjustment. But again, you're working off of a paltry amount of possession and territory. They didn't get too many opportunities, and I think Rory's right that you'd like to see them think their way through a game a bit. Teams will now take a leaf out of that. If I was playing Munster next week, I would be inclined to run a similar defensive pattern against them and see could they figure a way out of it, because they did struggle. But the overarching thing for me is that they didn't have a lot of ball anyway. I mean, they did well to hold Exeter to one score when the Exeter had 60 over 60% possession and over 60% territory. So you'd have to, that's part of the conversation. But I do think it's the one part of our game yet we've yet to see them, I suppose, pick teams apart strategically. They're capable of running over teams, but you won't run over Exeter, and you won't run over the big teams. And that's their next challenge, is to changed their attack to the point where they can pick teams apart by just taking them through phases and then making the line break to score. We see Leinster do it a lot all the time.
I think it should be noted as well that Exeter may not be a European power as such, and they may not have, you know, they've only got to the knockout stages once, but I think they're better than two or three of the teams that made the last eight. They somehow haven't been able to manage the pool stages. They haven't figured out the bonus points or whatever you need to get over the line. One of these years they will, and I think they'll go on a proper run. I think they are genuinely one of the top six teams in Europe, probably. They're probably better than Ulster and Edinburgh anyway. They just ended up in a pool with Munster and kind of screwed up over in Cast.
Yeah.
You know, it's an achievement to knock them out. They've taken a scalp in Exeter. It's not really seen that way because we've been very down on the English clubs, but that is the second best team in England, at least, that they've taken out of the equation. They've beaten the French champions as well.
And,
you know, Leinster beating Exeter last year was a bit of a springboard, though it was pretty ugly at the time.
Yeah.
So, you know, Exeter have been pretty unfortunate to come across Leinster and Munster as well.
No, it's true. How they mucked up at home to Gloucester, I'm sure they're wondering about Exeter as well. So Edinburgh away then, Eddie. Richard Cockerill has gone in there and done a job to much acclaim. They're second in conference B in the Pro 14, albeit 19 points behind Leinster. Grant Gilchrist was telling a story about when Cockerill arrived, and he came up to him in pre-season 27. He said he came up to me, he said he'd heard a lot of really good things about me, and then he said he'd watched me the previous season and he said he didn't know what the fuss was about, which is man management 101, I would think, from Richard Cockerill. So what has he done at Edinburgh over the last couple of seasons?
Well, I think what you see from Cockerill is what we used to see from Leicester when he played there, when he was middle of the front row in Leicester. It's very pragmatic rugby. They play like, I've noticed they play a style of rugby that suits Cockerill. If he was playing at hooker, you could see them playing like that.
Mm.
It's all about the nuts and bolts up front, you know, earning the right to go wide, good set piece, good maul, good at the breakdown, very aggressive. And, you know, he's put his stamp on the team and it's working for them, you know. I mean, probably Edinburgh is a team with similar players that have often been, I suppose. They lacked a sense of direction. They were soft touches. And it, that hard edge is coming to them now. And I think, to be fair to Cockerill, that's his MO, you know. He's a hard nut hooker. He played like a hard man. He coached like a hard man. And what just his quote there is not an arm around the shoulder comment. It's 6 inches lower with letters attached. So, he's that's the kind of... So I think he's got his stamp on Edinburgh. And he's getting the most out of them. I can't see them being European champions, and I can't even see them getting the semi-final. I think it's, you know, Munster would be favourites, even though they're in Edinburgh. But you have to give credit to them for bringing them where they are. They weren't mapped for... The last time they were mapped in Europe was when Ulster beat them, you know, and that was Ulster's year when they got to the final against Leinster. Brian McLaughlin was coach. They beat Munster in Tyrone Park. So that was the last time, and Mick Bradley was coaching Edinburgh. That's the last time they were kind of mapped, really.
Yeah.
So they're back again, but I think they might have hit their ceiling now. I really do. I don't know if they have the horses to beat Munster. But, you know, credit where credit is due to Cockerill. He's put his stamp on that team and they wear it well at the moment.
If Munster did have to go away in the quarterfinals and you offered them a choice of Saracens, Racing, Leinster, it's fairly obvious which one they would take. There were 11,000 at Murrayfield for the Montpellier game. It gets completely lost in the stadium. Cockerill saying we want 30, 40, 50,000 there for the quarterfinal. I mean, most of them could be Munster supporters, to be honest.
Yeah, it's kind of where good games go to die at Murrayfield, especially at club level. But it's where Irish teams have gone and perished in the past. Leinster famously, a few times, have lost big European games. I remember Munster under Rob Penny going over there and losing a game they should never have lost to an Edinburgh team that should never have beaten them. There is a capacity, like it's a reasonably big city. It's a capital city club. It has more probably tradition than Glasgow Warriors, who get bigger gates than them. There is a catchment there, and it would be good for the Pro 14 and for, you know, Scottish rugby to get more bums on seats behind a team like Edinburgh, because there's only two of them, and you know, it would be a healthy to see a bit of growth there. And Munster will bring a big crowd over. I think a lot of people will fancy a weekend in Edinburgh. It's a pretty easy place to get to as well. So I think there's capacity for a reasonably sized crowd, but even still, it's a 60,000-70,000 seater stadium, so it just does get swallowed up. And it's just, there's a running track, it's not a great atmosphere, and Munster often thrive on the crowd, often thrive on the occasion. They just need to be professional. If they can beat Edinburgh, they beat Edinburgh all the time in the Pro 14. They are a better team, particularly their first 23. It's a very much, you're right, like it's the most favourable draw they could have got. And they should be going to a semi-final.
Okay. We are streaming on Facebook, by the way, YouTube and Periscope, as well as going out on the radio later on this evening. So get your Heineken Star comments in and you can win yourself some off the ball branded Heineken prizes, including a signed rugby ball. So you were at Welford Road, Rory, and you were at the Ricoh Arena yesterday. Wasps 19, Leinster 37. Di Young with the quote of the weekend where he said, "You got to feel sorry for them when Jack Conan unfortunately doesn't play and they have to put up with Sean O'Brien. You really have to feel for them." And he talked, you know, at length about how highly he rates this Leinster team. Cronin twice, 6 tries in 6 games. Gary Ringrose, Noel Reid try at the end. On that point, Young was saying, like, look at the variety in the way they score tries. They can do it any which way they want. What did you make of it?
A bit of a non-event.
Yeah.
I mean, they said there was 16,000 in a Ricoh. It didn't look that, like, it wasn't a bad crowd, but it, you know, for considering Wasps were out, but it didn't feel like a big event. The pool stages have pretty much come to a conclusion. We were just, it was basically moving the deck chairs at that stage.
It did feel like the forgotten games of the weekend.
Yeah, and yeah. I think EPCR have to take a bit of a look at how uncompetitive the last weekend was. I know Exeter Munster was a proper occasion, but most of the teams had already qualified. You know, it isn't great that 10 of teams were already out before the last weekend of the tournament. Leinster went over, did the job. I mean, Dai Young, you've All Black number 10, you've about 4 or 5 England internationals in your team.
Yeah.
Like
Dara on YouTube as well, what do you think in the comments, given they've just signed Fekitoa and Tamaga Allen as well?
There's something wrong in Wasps, you know, there's a cultural issue there. They're not the sum of their parts. There's no way that team should be getting hammered routinely by Leinster.
Yeah. No wins across the pool.
No, and 3 years ago they hammered Leinster and they were, you know, they were all singing, all dancing. They looked really, really good. Mm. There's been, you know, lots of stuff behind the scenes. The move to Coventry hasn't been followed through with a kind of training facility. I think players feel there was broken promises. A number of leaving, including Elliot Daly, who came to their academy, really bad sign. It looks like he's gone to Saracens.
Yeah.
Just, there's a lot of discord there. But, you know, Leinster fielded a team of 14 Irish qualified players and one who'll be Irish qualified by the end of the year. These were not recruits from overseas. It's not like they've gone out and spent big. Like, you know, they're paying their players well.
Sure.
But they are Irish internationals. Most of them are homegrown. I don't think Dai Young can plead the poor mouth. You know, he's just signed Fekitoa. So they just didn't, like, you know, Exeter at least showed up. You know, they got knocked out at the end.
Yeah.
But Wasps didn't contribute anything to this tournament over the course of 6 games, which is, you know, they got to be, they're a big spending club. They're a big club. They've won this tournament twice. They've got to be better. But for Leinster, went over, did the job without Johnny Sexton for the last 2 rounds. They'll be disappointed that the loss in Toulouse ultimately cost them a home semi-final as well as a home quarter-final.
Yeah.
But even if they do have to, if they do get over the Ulster task and have to go to France, they'll be pretty confident that they can get that job done as well.
Eddie, it was striking. Maybe it's when you come off the back of watching the Munster-Exeter game, which of course is an entirely different game. But, you know, that first 15, 20, 25 minutes, Leinster just, the intensity, the pace they bring to their play, they kind of own the ball, you know, good breakdown work seems to be very quick, and they can just fizz the ball back across the pitch at a pace and with accuracy that other teams find very hard to live with, and certainly very few teams can mimic. And that kind of set the tone for the afternoon.
Yeah, I think I agree with Rory that Wasp didn't bring much to the party.
Right.
They're a team playing below what they should be playing at. They've plenty of good players. But there's a sense as well about Leinster that, how would you put it, at the moment, there's a thing when you play Leinster, there's an inevitability about when they get the ball, you're going to end up kicking it off the halfway line at some point. You know, it might take 30 phases, it might take 10, but they're going to score unless they drop a ball. You rarely get it back unless they make a mistake. So they have this capacity to hold on to the ball and wear you down. And you're right, they can do it by running over you, running around you, running through you. They just have all the tricks in their bag, and they're supremely confident now in themselves. They never change their tempo. You don't see with Leinster, like, suddenly they up the tempo or they down the tempo. They just play at a pace that you can't contain.
Yeah.
And I think that, like, it looked like a training run for the first 20 minutes. They were just, you know, get out of your half, win possession, find field position, wear Wasps down, score back to halfway. And I think at halftime, Wasps came out and played rather than they were looking like a 40-pointer at home in front of their own fans. And they came out and played a bit. But then you never thought Leinster were any doubt. And then you have someone like Keane Healy comes off the bench. You know, they have a very good squad. And we've been saying that. It's a very, very good club side.
Yeah.
But to be fair, they are playing, like, comfortably within themselves and still winning comfortably. They're not really, it's very hard to stretch Leinster. Now, you know, and Waston were getting to the tournament anyway, so I didn't think last Sunday was going, or yesterday was going to be something that was going to just come out of Leinster anyway. But I think they're now into the business end of it. I think they'll be happy enough taking Ulster to Dublin, and I think they'll still be favourites for the tournament. I think, yeah, Knight and Racing are dangerous, and I think Saracens are dangerous, but I just think Leinster, they've done it now already. Again, they're right where they want to be, and I just think, yeah, they're going to be in the semi final, and after that, it's you never know. But who'd back against them?
Yeah.
But for good reason, they're a bloody good side. They're well organised. They're well coached. They're oozing with confidence, and there's a lot of competition to get on that team. That's what keeps guys focused.
It's true. If you're interested, Keen Healy did some very interesting interviews in the build up to yesterday's game. People can check them out in the Sunday papers. He was talking about how he really was pretty much done. The insurance papers were on the table, ready to be signed, and Joe Schmidt gave him a call and urged him to rethink things a couple of years ago. So he seems to be in a good place now, that's for sure. We saw his break for the Noel Reid try. Sean O'Brien was back unexpectedly. Yep. So he played 56 minutes at number 8. How did he look?
He looked very good for the first half an hour, and then looked a little bit gassed after that, and Nathan Hughes went through him for one of Wasps' tries, which is very uncharacteristic, but I think probably forgivable given the fact that he hasn't played since November and hadn't probably played an awful lot before then either. So, you know, he's gotten a good body of work under his belt. Joe Schmidt, as far as we know, hasn't released him for the Scarlets game this weekend. He's brought him to Portugal, presumably with an eye for him to be involved in some capacity next weekend. I can't see him forcing Josh Van der Fleer out of the team just because Van der Fleer is playing well and he's very fit.
Yeah.
But, you know, what an impact sub to bring on if you do. Henshaw also came back and played really, really well. Didn't look like he'd any ill effects once again. Just
it's twice now he's done that. Yeah.
So he'll come very much into the frame for the Six Nations game. So, yeah, I mean, to be able to bring those two back for this game was great. And, yeah, Jack Conan picked up a shoulder injury, wasn't able to play. He was in Coventry, but wasn't able to play. But to be able to bring Sean O'Brien and then Max Deegan onto the bench, and then Deegan played a role in that Noel retry as well. So,
yeah,
it was all pretty positive for Leinster.
So, Welford Road then. Ulster 13 points to nil down. It seemed to be a horror first half.
Yeah.
What was going wrong?
They were losing the collisions, they were losing their line out, their scrum was under pressure, and Billy Burns looked like he was carrying the calf injury that stopped him from kicking and wasn't really able to get himself involved in the game. And I think they missed touch with a kick to the corner with Addison. Everything was going wrong.
Right.
I mean, it was worrying to see Rory Best throw kind of go so wobbly with the Six Nations in mind. Ian Henderson was one of the few plus points. He's now being ruled out, but they lost Coetzee after half an hour, but they got into the dressing room. McFarland said they just talked about the breakdown at halftime and their work in the tackle area. They'd gone 10-0 down, they went 13-0 down just after halftime, but they started getting a bit of momentum. They brought John Cooney on, and while Dave Shannon didn't play badly at all, Cooney just came on and there was a sense of calm throughout the team, and they just started making good decisions. The ball was quicker, he was snappier to the breakdown, he was getting the ball out, and suddenly Leicester were on the back foot, having been quite good without being excellent for the first 50 minutes. And, you know, they've got Balakoon, Stockdale, you know, have that ability to beat men in the wide channels. Their maul went forward, they got the try, and then quickly afterwards, Burns, probably the only real input that he had into the game, a lovely chip for Balakoon to go through, and suddenly, you know, Cooney nails the touchline conversion to 14-13 up, and they defended really well to get home. So they were much better against Racing. Before the start of the season, no one would have backed them to get into the quarterfinal. It's a great achievement. McFarland really deserves a lot of credit for it. Probably wasn't as good a pool as it looked on paper, but at the same time, they got there. And whatever happens against Leinster in the quarterfinal, they have overperformed to get to where they are, I think. And for all that they didn't play well on Saturday, it's still a good achievement to get there.
Nobody was predicting Balakoon was scoring 3 tries in 6 games before the season. The likes of O'Sullivan, Marty Moore, Jordy Murphy, Will Addison, all the recruitment is starting to prove a big success as well. And that is difficult to predict before the start of the season.
Absolutely. It's a real blend. I mean, there's only, I think it was 5 homegrown Ulster players in the starting 15. They had 4 Irish qualified players from abroad, I think, 4 from Leinster, and then Marcel Coetzee in there as well. So they've blended it together, but the players all seem to be buying in. You know, they may not be from Ulster, but they're playing for the jersey. They're playing for McFarland, who came in, you know, midway through pre-season. You know, Simon Easterby took some of pre-season. So, you know, it was a disjointed approach to the season. It was interesting. Jarrod Payne was sitting behind us, and he was, you know, a very cool, calm, collected character in my experience, and he was going absolutely mental in the coach's box throughout the second half. You know, there's just a sense that there's a collective there now. Mm. They've come through their horrible year that they had. A year ago, they were facing into the, just everything that was going to happen in the next couple of months, and it's just a very different place now.
Is this the same Jarrod Payne who was grinning with his hands behind his head with about four minutes to go in Belfast?
Yeah, this was a much different persona, but it was interesting to see. Those English grounds are very tight. You get the, much closer to the press.
They're great.
Yeah, they're great.
They're brilliant. Yeah. What did you make of this one, Eddie?
Yeah, I thought, I was worried for Ulster come to halftime, particularly when Leicester scored. I thought, you know, this is really going to test them out. But credit where credit is due, wasn't a tremendously good game of rugby. It was very intense, but they held their nerve. And I think once they got the first score, if they could just keep their foot on the pedal, they'd nick it. But it was very tight. And let's be honest, Leicester are not a great team. They look pretty clueless what they were at. You know, they're not a bad team, but they just seem like they're brittle as well. If you can get in under their skin at all, they just kind of don't believe they can win. They've lost a lot of games this year. So, but it took Ulster a while to make that happen. But credit where credit is due, they did. And once they got their nose in front, I just felt they were going to, I couldn't see them losing it. They were going to hang in there. It was one of those moments. If Ulster had lost on the weekend, particularly if Leicester had come back, it could have derailed their season. So there was a lot of chips on the table in the last 10 minutes, and I just felt the way the ball was breaking from them as well, the way they were hunting in defence, that they were going to get it done. But it's great for them. I think it draws a line in the sand for the season, and they just focus now on you know, having a crack against Leinster. Nobody expects them to win in Dublin, and just focus on getting into the playoffs and in the Pro 14. Like, it just changed the whole, I suppose, the whole perspective on the season, that win.
Yeah, absolutely. So there is something fantastically funny about the fact that the day after Brexit kicks in, there will be up to 13,000 Ulster fans coming down to Dublin. So they're pushing for, I think, 5:30 kickoff if they can on the Saturday, but all of that remains to be seen, and I'm sure television will have it. Say, Leo Cullen referenced the Thomond Park win for Ulster a good few years ago now, to be fair. Look, it's very hard to see anything beyond Leinster winning at home. As things shape up, the most likely scenario, if we are to really get ahead of ourselves here, is Saracens at home to Munster. And I don't know who you think is going to come out on top between Racing and Toulouse, but let's say for a moment it's Racing. Racing at home to Leinster. So two away semi-finals for the Irish provinces, Rory.
Yeah, I think I've been pretty confident all season that would be the final four. That, you know, Toulouse could rattle Racing, but yeah. Racing have... You know, at their best, they're a bit fast and loose this season, but at their best, they're still in that top four teams. It's almost a closed shop with those four teams, and I don't see anyone breaking into it.
Apologies, quick tangent. A few people wondering this. For instance, Colin McCullough. Toulouse, did they choose Racing over Leinster in that second half yesterday?
I wasn't watching it, but from listening to people on social media and other people who were watching it, it sounds like they pulled up. They started taking their try threats off.
A few knock-ons.
Yeah, exactly. But that's just clever. Oh, you know, why go to Dublin to take on the champions when you could go up the road much more comfortable? I don't really have much problem with that.
Anyway, sorry.
Yeah, and they'll give it a good shot against Racing. Yeah. Ulster will come down to seven former Leinster players or people who grew up in Leinster in their team. They're going to have a lot of pride on the line. Some of them will have a chip on their shoulder. It could be Rory Best last season. We don't know yet, but you know, there's a cause there. They'll give Leinster a real go. I don't think they're good enough to beat them, but I think it'll be tighter than the 17-point spread that's out there. Munster will be confident of going across. So yeah, two away semi-finals on the cards. Unless Glasgow upset the apple cart with Saracens, and they were tight for about 60 minutes on Saturday, but there is, I suppose, a familiarity there. They've played in the quarterfinal quite recently, and they played twice this season.
Yeah,
I think Leinster won't fear going to Paris or Bordeaux or wherever that game is on, even though Racing's best performance in the last couple of years came in that semi against Munster last year. Leinster's a very different proposition, and Munster didn't show up that day. Saracens away is a very difficult task if Munster were to get there, but it's not exactly like Saracens don't have a huge support. It's not like going away to play them is going to be like Saracens were just as good in the Aviva Stadium 2 years ago.
Where will they play that Saracens?
Hard to know. That could be anywhere from Milton Keynes to Wembley. You just don't know.
Yeah.
So
it'd be interesting to see if they want an artificial pitch or not.
Yeah, it's doable. I think I think Leinster still look like the stronger of the two teams to make it. But Munster's 23 is capable on its day of beating on it. They're certainly better set up to beat Saracens than they were 2 years ago when they played them.
Eddie, do you see it as Saracens, Munster and Racing, Leinster?
Yeah, I'd agree with that. You never know, it's cup rugby, but I think if you're trying to be logical about it, that's where it should fall. And I still think they're two tough away games. I still think we could have a, we could have a European final without any Irish teams in it. Like, it could go against us. Very hard to win away from home in a semi-final. And I think Saracens, watching them again on the weekend, especially if they missed Farrell badly. He was gone on the weekend. They missed him badly, but they still got the job done. I think if Farrell is playing, they're a really good outfit. And I still think Racing ran a mission. You know, they've been in a few finals. Jackie Lorenzetti wants a European trophy. And they're playing like a French team who are on a mission, which is dangerous. So I think Munster and Leinster will get to the semi final, but I'm not sure that they might get to the final. The winning those away, but it'd be some end to the season if they both once have played Leinster in the Europe final. But there is a waning at the moment of the influence of France and England in the tournament over the last few years. The Pro 14 teams are getting more of a toehold in the quarterfinals, and you know you can miss that by saying, oh well, last year was a Leinster and French, Irish and a French team. 2 years ago, it was two French teams, or you know, it was Saracens and a French team. But if you look at the quarterfinal spread, there was 1 year there where there was no one from the Pro 14 in the quarterfinal. That's changed in the last few years. We've had a presence there now. In fairness, the Irish teams have been the ones that have been making the biggest impact. But Glasgow have come in, now Edinburgh in as well. And there's more of the Pro 14 having a footprint in the final eight of Europe. And this is the biggest one yet, 5 out of 8, which is a big one. But still in all, that's no guarantee any Pro 14 teams will get to the final. But yeah, it's going. I agree with Rory's summation of it there. I think that's pretty much where it's going to be at.
Okay. Peter is watching in. I know Eddie will appreciate this. For me, Leinster are like the New England Patriots of club rugby. You always get the feeling the result is a foregone conclusion, which is a powerful thing for both Leinster themselves and the fear factor it puts into opponents, says Pete. Yeah, are you bleary-eyed up late last night watching the Patriots?
Was, yeah. What's done up for though, man? It was unreal.
A coaching masterclass, I'm being reliably told.
Yeah, from both coaches, in fairness, you know, it was really top-end stuff. And you thought the Patriots had locked it up, and then, you know, Kansas go down and they tie it up. And then, but I think once the Patriots won the toss and took the football, I just felt bad for Kansas that we're going to go down and get it done. But it was great football, isn't it? But the big controversy over the weekend is the really bad call in the other playoff game, which is amazing because, like, you think we tend to be harsh on rugby and referees here, but you think the NFL is the greatest thing ever. They had one of the worst calls ever. That's probably cost the New Orleans Saints a place in the Super Bowl. So that's the controversy today. But I thought there were two great games. I really enjoyed them, but I paid the price this morning when I woke up. I was bleary-eyed.
I think the league called the Saints afterwards almost immediately to apologise for the mistake. So who's your pick for the Super Bowl then?
I still go with the Patriots. I think LA were lucky to get there, and they'll be happy to get there. And I think Belichick, with 2 weeks prepare, I'd look out. You know, I think they're on, like, again, they just seem to keep wanting to set records, and they're in a position to set another one now. So I think the Patriots. But had it been the New Orleans Saints, I wouldn't have been as confident.
Right. Did you borrow much from NFL in your coaching career in rugby?
Yeah, lots of different ways, you know, but communication systems, you know, breaking stuff down on defense, like going down into micro, like on certain situations where players have to understand exactly what the priority is right now, this moment, and it's not something else, you know, that kind of stuff. I mean, in terms of technique, tactical, the other one is the brilliant at managing the clock, which we've had to figure out in rugby. We haven't managed to figure out how to manage the clock in rugby because you see teams like, you know, waste time in the last 2 or 3 minutes of the game, and they need to keep the ball in play, or teams keeping it in play, but they need to get it out of play. You see all this kind of lack of understanding. You see how last night in that game with, you know, the Patriots take the lead literally with like 40 seconds on the clock, and you know, Kansas drive it down and would manage the clock perfectly in that 40 seconds to tie the game. Like, they do that in basketball as well. We haven't got to that point yet in rugby. Right. And you still see teams kind of flitter away time at the end of the game that's very important to them. Like, they might make a conversion, or the kicker spends a minute making a conversion. It doesn't matter. They've got to get back to halfway, get the ball, and try and score a try. And he runs a minute off the clock, making sure he curves the ball inside the post for 2 points. It doesn't matter. It's a try is important. It's just funny. Like, you see those situations that they wouldn't go unnoticed in American sports. They're more aligned to that.
Yeah, okay, interesting. Before we go, Connacht beat Bordeaux 33 points to 27. They were 8 points down with 10 minutes to go, so they're going to have Sale away in the Challenge Cup quarterfinal. There was a period where it looked like we're going to have a repeat of all the pool stages in the Champions Cup. It's been averted. I'd say they're quite pleased it's happened.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
It would have been a big talking point, but Connacht will have Sale away again.
Just keeps the momentum going for Connacht. You know, I mean, this hasn't been a priority this tournament. He's rotated his squad quite heavily through it. He's given a couple of debuts in it. He's used it to rest players for the Pro 14. It's quite clear that the Pro 14 is their main priority, but having a quarterfinal, albeit away from home in Stockport, is something to look forward to for the players. You know, there's a good number of them gone off to international camp now. Delan is looking like he's probably going to be on the bench for England, which is another kind of bit of progress for them, because you know, the more numbers they get, the better. And to go to Bordeaux and get that result was a really, really impressive result. And it's to do that while rotating their squad over the course is pretty good. I say they'll back themselves. I mean, Sale have a good, strong team, and they did a number on them over there. But in a quarter final, the way they're playing with the kind of threats that they offered, they have a chance to keep the whole dream of a couple of Irish teams getting to Newcastle alive.
So, while European rugby is parked for the time being, Six Nations is here. Rory O'Connor from the Irish Independent and Eddie O'Sullivan. Thanks, lads. We'll talk to you soon.
Cheers up.
Monday Night Rugby on Off the Ball